A cut on the United States credit rating. Fitch slashed America's long-term default rating from AAA to AA+, pointing to what it called an erosion of governance. The agency notes there has been a steady deterioration in governance standards in Washington in the last 20 years, including on fiscal and debt matters. Its decision also comes in the wake of political wrangling over borrowing and repeated standoffs over raising the debt limit. The Biden administration slammed Fitch's move, the White House calling the downgrade as defying reality under an economic rebound since President Joe Biden took office. U.S. Treasury Chief Janet Yellen, meanwhile, called Fitch's move arbitrary and based on outdated data. Here's how financial markets reacted to the lower U.S. credit rating, the major indices in the Asia-Pacific region seeing sharp losses on Wednesday, with Japan's Nikkei 225 leading the slump at more than 2.3%. The Hang Seng was also down by 2%, followed by the Kospi, even as South Korea's inflation in July slightly dropped. The ASX 200 also in the red as traders there digest the Reserve Bank of Australia's latest pause in its rate hiking. Let's take a look now at futures in Europe. Markets are expected to mirror the downswing in Asia as the U.S. credit rating downgrade added to worries about slowing economic growth in the region. The German DAX and CAC 40 are seen to drop 1% each. Over on Wall Street, futures also pointing lower following the Fitch downgrade. More earnings on deck, including CVS Health.
Now, Ayala Land saw its second quarter bottom line jumping to 6.9 billion pesos, which is 52% higher quarter on quarter. This brings its first half net income to 11.4 billion pesos. The real estate developer attributes this increase to higher residential project completion, bookings, and sales of commercial and industrial lots and office units. For its subsidiary, Ayala Land Logistics, it reported flat earnings in the first half of the year at 339 million pesos. This followed a 9% slump in warehouse leasing, which offset small gains from the sale of industrial lots, cold storage revenue, and commercial leasing. Meanwhile, Metrobank says its profit grew 34% in the first half to 20.9 billion pesos, driven by its asset expansion, higher margins, and healthy fee income growth. This translates to a 12.9% return on equity, which is 10% higher year-on-year.
Country's flag carrier, Philippine Airlines, joins the NFT craze. PAL jointly launched with Blockchain Technologies a set of non-fungible tokens with 8 art pieces priced at $5,000 or about 275,000 pesos each. Among the NFTs designed by artist Trace Orozco are the PAL Iconic Airplane Tail and the PAL Iconic Arroz Caldo. Now, the limited digital collectibles is being offered with in partnerships with the Philippine Blockchain Week, set to be held this September. Manila's top economist is confident government can achieve its 6-7% economic growth target this year despite a slowdown among its trade partners. NEDA Secretary Arsenio Balisacan tells ANC the country only needs an average of 5.9% for the last three quarters of the year to hit a 6% growth. The Philippine economy expanded 6.4% in the first quarter.
The trick is to ensure that the domestic economy is working well. And I think we have that move for us to remove all restrictions in the pertaining to the COVID-19 is a good support to that effort. The effort focus on the an infrastructure, an investment, particularly and the ease of doing business in the country.
Balisacan also saying the damage caused by recent calamities is not that substantial. The country recorded 5.4 billion pesos worth of agriculture and infrastructure damage due to Typhoon Egay and the southwest monsoon.
So far, in the case of basic commodities like rice, we have adequate stocks. I think that a lot of the imports came in the first half of the year, and that I think allows us to have that buffer. In the meantime, I think that the impact on inflation is not going to be that much, but it's still, you know, as I said, the events are still unfolding, and the thing is, this is July, August, and so it's not really the harvest season in many parts of the country for the basic agricultural products. So and it's so I think that the damage is not that substantial, and so I do think that the impact on the overall national economy is that serious at this point.
The Philippine government formally proposes a 5.76 trillion peso national budget for next year. Budget Secretary Amena Pangandaman transmitted to Congress on Wednesday a copy of the proposed outlay. Now, the Marcos administration is eyeing a spending plan that's 9.5% higher than this year's. Broken down, social services will get 2.18 trillion pesos, while 1.7 trillion pesos will go to economic services. Some 700 billion pesos, or 12% of the budget, will go to debt burden. The education sector is still getting the lion's share of the outlay, followed by transportation, public works, social welfare, and health. Secretary Pangandaman vows government will continue to invest on infrastructure to spur economic growth.
Infrastructure development is one of the key drivers of our continuing economic growth. As such, we will sustain this momentum through Build Better More program with 1.42 trillion pesos, equivalent to 5.3% of our GDP. This will prioritize physical connectivity infrastructure such as road networks and railway systems, which will cover almost half, or 43.5% of the budget.
House Speaker Martin Romualdez vows Congress will prioritize the passage of the spending bill.
The national budget is crucial to maintaining economic stability, sustaining the country's growth trajectory, and facilitating the seamless implementation of government projects and programs. As such, it demands the House's utmost attention and commitment.
President Marcos met with executives of Singapore-based Kasifik Broadband Satellites in Malacañang. The digital connectivity, of course, and cybersecurity topping that agenda. Marcos emphasized the need for the country to catch up with its Asian neighbors. He also directed the ICT department as well as the Science and Technology department to determine specific terms with Kasifik on how to boost the country's digital capability. Kasifik is planning to launch its Kasifik 2 satellite to add capacity to its existing satellite, the Kasifik 1, which was launched in 2019. Illicit tobacco trade could cost the Philippines some 30 billion pesos in lost revenues this year. That's according to the National Tobacco Administration. Jackie Pascual joins us on the line for details on this story. Hi, Jackie. What can you tell us?
Hi, good afternoon, Stanley. About 16 billion pesos in revenue is lost due to the illicit tobacco trade in the Philippines so far this year. The NTA, or the National Tobacco Administration, said the figure is still expected to go up, affecting many farmers this 2023. At the International Tobacco and Agricultural Summit in Taguig, NTA Administrator Belinda Sarmiento Sanchez said the agency continues to help local farmers because of the illegal trade, which covers smuggling and unregistered cigarettes. NTA said that illicit tobacco trade can possibly reach 30 billion pesos of losses this year. This includes smuggling, illicit manufacturing. The NTA has no police powers, so the agency is coordinating with law enforcement agencies to prevent the illegal trade. Aside from the illicit trade, NTA said the government's anti-smoking campaign and the higher taxes on cigarettes are also negatively affecting the tobacco industry. But the agency continues to urge farmers who left the industry to return to planting tobacco, as they will now focus on exporting. According to the 2021-2022 data of NTA, 53% of tobacco in the country are exported, while 47% are sold to local manufacturers. Top countries receiving tobacco from the Philippines are the U.S., Dominican Republic, Belgium, Indonesia, and the UAE. One of the speakers, Stanley, is Michael Tan, director of LT Group, which owns and distributes most cigarette brands in the Philippines. He said there is a need to help the tobacco industry as it is still benefiting millions of Filipinos and that revenues from the sector, he said, will help in infrastructure development, healthcare, and education in many regions. So Stanley, the summit is still ongoing and it will end tomorrow. That's the latest. Back to you.
All right, Jackie, since that's an agricultural summit for tobacco planters, I'm sure a lot of other issues were discussed there. By any chance, was there some dedicated discussions or conversations about moves to actually help farmers transition to other crops given the tightening restrictions on smoking in the country? There were groups in March calling for the government to actually help farmers transition to other crops instead of continuing tobacco production.
That's right, Stanley. Some of the speakers mentioned that there are urging also tobacco farmers to plant alongside tobacco other crops since there is, because of the higher taxes of cigarettes as well as this illicit trade that affected many farmers. So they are urging also farmers to plant other kinds of crops. Although the NTA mentioned that they are also urging farmers to return.
Which I think is counterintuitive.
Yeah, that's right, Stanley. There are several sectors are part of this summit, and they are discussing ways on how to balance this act. Some are urging farmers to return to planting tobacco, while others are also urging them to plant other crops since the possibility of a lower demand in cigarettes. So that's one of the aim or the goals of this summit is to have that. And hopefully, they said that there will be more discussions within the day as well as tomorrow. Stanley?
All right. Thank you so much for the update, Jackie Pascual.